Vielen herzlichen Dank für die freundliche Einführung. Ich habe auch wieder Kollege Schmiedl mir gedacht, aufgrund der internationalen Konfiguration werde ich den Vortrag auf Englisch halten, aber die Diskussion kann gern in verschiedenen Sprachen, die in Zusagen gehalten werden, die hier präsent sind. Also, the grotesque is reflexive figure of the revolution. The revolution and the grotesque belong together like two peas in a pod. That is, if we rely on eyewitness accounts of the 1790s and their aftermath. It may come as something of a surprise how little sustained reflection this linkage between the grotesque and the revolution has invited so far, particularly since its study can serve as a crucial building block for a social and cultural theory of the age of revolutions. The grotesque, of course, has a long and venerable pedigree that stretches back from the mural decorations of the Domus Aurea over the Romanesque and Gothic gargoyles and grimaces whom Bernard of Clairvaux chastised as Formosa deformitas, to the capricci with their skewed spaces, goblins, harlequins, and harlots. Across genres and forms of art, the grotesque denotes the eruption of the shape-shifting, smudgy, and sinister, a mundus inversus in which frontiers between high and low, inside and outside, familiar and strange, are effectively blurred. This transgression is a salient theme of my talk, tangible from its earliest Saturnalian instances, like Seneca's Apocolocyntosis Divi Claudii on the pumpkinification of Emperor Claudius. The 18th century grotesque, for whose study versatile Bornacini provides an excellent springboard, also supplies a perfect showcase of the processes we study at the Institute of Culture Studies and Theatre History, namely the interactive knowledge-making, including its artistic guises and varieties, scenographic modes of staging, as well as the subversive translation of sujets and techniques, as can be seen in Watteau's replacement of the zoomorphic bestiary imagery of his teacher with figures gleaned from the Italian Commedia dell'arte in the Hotel de Noantel from 1708, today the Maison de Polytechnicien. Goya's reworking of his Italian sketch and scrapbook designs inspired by the Venetian carnival into the Madrilenian street scenes that provided the material for his caprichos. In order to get a better grasp of the revolutionary grotesque that crystallized in the 1790s, it's imperative to clarify its key motifs. One such guiding theme, beguilingly exemplified again by Goya, is profanation. E.g., in Non grites tonta, number 74 of the Capricci, with sneering gremlin-like monks in a state of dental disrepair floating above an enticed young lady. A neat prefiguration of a dignified theme, the painting Goya did for the chapel of San Fernando de Monte Torero at Saragossa, where levitating Saint Isidore encourages Ferdinand III of Castile to reconquer Seville from the Moors in 1247. By the same token, Goya's conflation of the corozas, the cone-shaped hats worn by pilgrims and flagellants during the Holy Week, with bishops' split mitres put on by the witches assembled in his sabbats and by the victims of the Inquisition, makes us aware of a process of strategic travesty that makes the sacred and the heretic coincide. For the purposes of our conference, the French Revolution is important because it signifies something of a watershed in the development of the grotesque. It shifts the old imagery of the mundus inversus with its sexual, scatological, and gluttonous ribaldry to cover a new subject, the conglomerate revolutionary body politic, characterized by popular sovereignty and the levée en masse. In doing so, the revolutionary hurly-burly was significant also because it saturated the grotesque with a strong political import and made it applicable to novel subjects that redefine the political body, namely to the figure of the automaton, while giving the old theme of cannibalistic self-destruction a centerpiece of civil war literature, at least since Lucan's Pharsalia, a fresh twist. Edmund Burke's writings on the revolution made the biggest splash in those years. Burke's reading of the revolution as a grotesque suffuses his famous Reflections on the Revolution in France where he describes his subject matter as, quote, a vast, tremendous, unformed specter that had arisen from the tomb of murdered monarchy. Burke likened the misdeeds of the French revolutionaries to the cure Medea suggested to the daughters of King Pelias of Iolcus, who cooked their father with poisonous wormwood and wild incantations in the hope of rejuvenating him. France, Burke says, was a universal empire not grounded in any balance. Edmund Burke goes on to describe the French National Assembly as a, quote, profane burlesque. His account is replete with references to the rustic, histrionic, and gesticulatory. He sees the deputies of the assembly as, quote, comedians of a fair before a riotous audience. Quote Burke, the members of the National Assembly act amidst the tumultuous cries of a mixed mob of ferocious men and of women lost to shame, who according to their insolent fancies direct, control, applaud, explode them, and sometimes mix and take seats among them, domineering over them with their strange mixture of servile petulance and proud, presumptuous authority. They have inverted order in all things. The gallery is the place of the house. The assembly, which overthrows kings and kingdoms, has not even the physiognomy and aspect of a grave legislative body, nec color imperii, nec frons erat ulla senatus. They have a power given to them like that of the evil principle to subvert and destroy, but not to construct, except such machines as may be fitted for further subversion and further destruction. Echoing Mirabeau's remark about the assemblée as vessel of the state. Burke's argument that gives the system based on kingship, chivalry, and clerical learning the pristine legitimacy of the natural order failed to carry the day. Simultaneously, monarchy had already become something artificial. It shifts from an incarnation of divine grace into a robotic automaton. Akin to Vaucanson's canard digérateur, the digesting and defecating duck. To be a king requires only the animal figure of man, a sort of breathing automaton. Thomas Paine, the great champion of the rights of man and Burke's chief antagonist in the great transatlantic debate in the revolution, wrote in his rejoinder to Burke. And Robespierre, in his speech of 1794, speaks of Louis XVI as automate couronné. The king here is crucially deprived of its voice, now embodied by the people, which adopts the vocalizing and scansion of popular sovereignty, and without its coil spring-like intestines. Let me now turn to three motifs of this revolutionary grotesque. The first motif is the composite body, and you will see the talk Burke has of the specter rising from the grave of monarchy neatly mirrored in this satiric print by James Gillray, one of the greatest satirists of the revolutionary era. If we wish to get a sense of the counter-revolutionary images of the spoofy French body politic, an artist who deserves pride of place is the British master caricaturist James Gillray, employed by William Pitt the Younger's Foreign Secretary George Canning to supply satirical prints for the anti-revolutionary journal Anti-Jacobin. Among them, the destruction of the French colossus from 1798. The monstrous body of France, artificially pieced together, is torn apart by a sheaf of thunderbolts that emanate from the hand of Imperial British Providence. The skull infested with venomous snakes twining, alluding to the fury as emblematic figure of the perpetual doomsday of civil war with its ceaseless cycles of revenge and retaliation. It's easy to see how Gillray got this bee in his bonnet. Jacobin imagery was full of meticulously choreographed feasts of unity that wielded together the nation into one body. And Erasmus Darwin, Charles's grandfather, member of the Francophile Birmingham Lunar Society in 1791, imagined France as a hecatonchiron giant ignited by the flame of patriotism and held together by galvanic energy. Endowed with a voice, Erasmus Darwin says, that rolls like heaven's own thunder round the echoing poles, quote, gathering in its shade the living world. This world, too, becomes a grotesque comestible, a the grotesque comestible, as in the plump pudding, Gilray imagined, carved up by Pitt and voracious gutter-snipe-looking Napoleon, who bit off more than he could chew. Now back to the fractured giant. The right hand of the colossus rests on the guillotine, emblazoned with fraternité, whereas we see the book Religion de la Nature with its key motifs, injustice, oppression, murder, destruction, dropping from the tottering giant's left hand. Gilray's figure has the decollated head of Louis XVI dangling around its neck like a cannibalistic South Sea chieftain's trophy. Which leads me to the second motif, the cannibals. The Jacobins who fashioned themselves as defenders of humankind against its enemies, the hostis humani generis, are strategically dehumanized. Pantagruelian gusling and chewing features prominently in the work of James Gilray. Here the banquet on display shows the nation devouring itself, un petit souper à la parisienne, a family of sansculottes refreshing after the fatigues of the day, from the 20th September 1792. Ragamuffin sansculottes feast on the flesh of their co-citizens, while using a female corpse as a chair, sitting bare-bottomed not only on her, but also on the French royal insignia and Louis d'Ors, while the Jacobin offspring nibbles on citizens' entrails. The family keeps more bodily remnants in the hand luggage compartment of their dilapidated home, as can be gleaned from the informative caption and epigram extempore on seeing the above print. And now on human flesh they gnaw, and every day is Mardi Gras. A crucial and noteworthy shift can be identified here. The cannibalistic motif once used to castigate the monarch and his entourage of leeches sucking the marrow of the people is resignified here to tar the rabble, the bloodthirsty Jacobins. Third, the automata and technical devices. George Cruikshank's satiric print, A Radical Reformer, I.E. It is a neck or nothing man, dedicated rather pointedly to the heads of the nation in 1819. Inspired by Gilray's style, Cruikshank's flame-belching guillotine monster on its grisly feet chases the heads of the nation, Foreign Secretary Lord Castlereagh, Prime Minister Lord Liverpool, the Prince Regent who lost his wig, to which the Chancellor says, as long as you have your head on, should be happy. Who flee in despair. What is interesting about the entry of these automata into the world of anti-revolutionary grotesque is their ambiguity. While Gilray had prepared the imagery of the blade-headed guillotine, what becomes tangible in Cruikshank's work is the ludicrously inflated fear of universal suffrage that united Lord Liverpool's government rendered as an obscenely rich, self-serving clique. Cruikshank's gory image of the radical reformer is a parody of loyalist paranoid fantasies about omnipresent republican interlopers and closet Jacobins that characterized his days. Gilray's own 1799 exhibition of a democratic transparency uses the technical entertainment equipment of his day to scornfully imply this conclusion. The print allegedly refers to dark sketches of a revolution found among the papers of the Jacobin society lately apprehended in Britain by a government report. In the foreground, Fox, leader of the Francophile segment of the Whigs, and his associates turn away their heads in horror, giving the impression of having been caught plotting red-handed. Yet instead of exhibiting an actual Jacobin plot, the print shows that the insurrectionary narrative is actually the product of the report itself. By throwing a light on these original documents, the report is likened to an illumination, a form of popular visual spectacle, in which a powerful light magnified and projected an image painted on a transparent screen, only by the assistance of artificially enhanced illumination. Loyalist fantasy. A small-scale, fragmented group of radical political cells could be transformed into a vision of national revolution. The dazzling light of Gilray's democratic transparency connotes the hyperbolic figment of the loyalist imagination, not the penetrating beams of sublime truth. Let me come to some concluding remarks. Since the revolution, monarchists and republicans depicted each other as beasts and dissolved the Enlightenment order of nature into a set of rival social models whose proponents mutually accused each other of sacrilegious defiguration. Concomitantly, the old satire of the ruler was transformed into a pathological reading of the rebel. Those who lived through the revolution perceived their epoch as an age of form failure. Three chief results of the revolutionary era stand out. First, the grotesque served as a site of contestation where the frontiers between the self and the other, above and below, as well as between civilization and barbarism, were constantly redrawn, merged into one, and subjected to playful travesty. Second, the collective body politic, its disproportionality, frail composition and ailments, the capacity of machines to serve as its vessel or mock mouthpiece, became an object of choice for the creators of grotesques. The asylum would be interesting if we think of Edgar Allan Poe's system of Professor Tarr and Dr. Feather. Third, the grotesque became one of the ideological crucibles of a world civil war unleashed by the French Revolution, making the world an object of conquest and consumption that could be reflected in the medium of the grotesque. What then became of the abiding subversive purchase of the grotesque? In 1790, Burke, and this is my final point, spoke of the swinish multitude under whose hoofs civilization will be crushed. But the subversive logic of the grotesque allows for a crucial plebeian spin. The analogous internal enemies built up separately by the patricians of their respective polities can come together in a pacifist, so to speak, cosmopolitarian vision. In a pun on Spivak's famous essay, one might say the subaltern can grunt. In 1832, an Anglo-Irish broadsheet took up Edmund Burke's words, showing two pigs in uniform massacring each other, a heading for the swinish multitude's catechism, pledging pigs and piglets fraternity across the Herring Brook, the great channel separating British Isles from France, and putting an end to butchery in the name of the balance of power and of monarchs ruling, as it says in the catechism, by the grease of God. Thank you for your attention.